Hey guys, this is Nick at Press Play. Well, the weekend of the 16th, I went to Indiecade East in New York, and in these special features, I wanted to share with you the raw audio interviews I'm using to write my coverage. But keep in mind that these are the original interviews, so they're not as squeaky clean as our official podcasts, but I hope you enjoy this look into my process, and most of all, I hope you enjoy the information. Alrighty, so we're at Indiecade East 2013, and I am talking to Richard, who made Cart Life. How are you doing, sir?
Oh, it's been great. This place is fantastic.
So for anybody who doesn't know Cart Life, can you give me sort of the basic idea?
Oh, sure. Well, it's a retail simulation, you know. It's kind of like Farmville, I suppose. You know?
Yeah, exactly like that.
Yeah, you know, how much are you gonna charge for lattes, and what do you pay your stand like? Which part of town are you gonna set up in? That kind of stuff, you know. What's it like to sell coffee for a living? But there's also newspapers. There's a guy who sells bagels, you know. But you can sell soda and different things. It's up to you. Make choice, you know.
And that's the entirety of the game, right?
Well, those are the salient parts, I suppose. Those are the kind of video game parts. But I kind of wanted to, you know, tell some kind of more personal stories along with the player, too. So, you know, maybe between the two of us, me being the developer, you being the player, maybe we can tell a worthwhile story. You know?
So, I mean, not to shatter the illusion here, but the game is pretty heavily focused on life simulator and a little bit less focused on the Farmville aspect that you discussed earlier. Not to say that you're a liar, sir.
Well, you know, I consider it more maybe kind of a bottleneck, you know, kind of give us some shared territory to start this thing on, and then as long as we understand that the basic premise is that this is it's concerned with how, you know, personal finances relate to business finances in small business. And so, you know, when you're using the same money to buy your business equipment that you use to pay your rent with, you know, that's kind of where the story begins.
So one really compelling aspect to you know, go off of that, that you encounter really from the beginning of the game is, like, time management is so, it's portrayed in this way that makes it feel so constricting. And especially with sort of the walking or bus or taxi aspect, it really sort of just makes you so nervous. Can you sort of explain how you arrived at this?
Yeah, I don't want players to master the game immediately, because I want their confusion to parallel the players themselves, the player characters, I mean. And so, like, for example, one of the characters sells newspapers. He's new to town, and he doesn't know where everything is. He doesn't know how much time it's going to take to get home from work. He doesn't know where to buy cat food, right? And so the player, the first time, they don't know those things either. Yeah. So they share that, and it's easier for the player to kind of beam down into his brain and become this guy and kind of fill his shoes with their own toes, right? And so the time constraint is kind of a way of kind of focusing that device and kind of making it challenging in the way that it would be challenging for you. And it was for me, you know, when I've been in situations like that in new towns, or short on money or short on time, those are the kind of challenging aspects that I think can unite the player and the character and me. And if we have this mutual understanding, it's a good way to keep us all kind of honest with each other.
So since we're discussing sort of the player mirroring these characters, can you sort of give us a backstory on both of the characters, and if you want, the third character as well?
Yeah, sure. Well, originally I had this idea where, you know, kind of like video games have this way of giving the first choice you make in a game is which player you'll be, which player character, like Gauntlet, or, you know, like RPGs or something where different characters have different abilities that maybe suit different styles of play. And that's the idea here, is that, so you have, we have a single mom named Melanie who is starting a food cart. She left her old job and she's trying to prove to a judge that she can make enough money to keep custody of her daughter. And she's living with her sister and she's trying to get a coffee cart up and running. That's one of the stories. And then a guy named Andrus Poder, he's a Ukrainian immigrant. He sells newspapers in a new town. He's never been here, and he lives in a hotel. And his cat, Mr. Glimbovsky, is his companion. And he's not supposed to have the cat. It's kind of against the rules of the hotel, so he's got to keep him a secret, and that's kind of where we begin. kind of more free character anyways, free in the behavioral sense, but certainly the least free in the financial sense, because I'd asked $5 for maybe a date with Vinny from anyone who's still interested somehow. I would say, he left town a long time ago. When he found his way back to Georgetown, he's got to sell bagels now, place to live. Gives him something to eat and hopefully a way to pay the bills.
So, sort of, you know, there's these steps to forming your business before you even really form it. And sort of tell me, and everybody at home, sort of how this story progresses. And I've never gotten to the end game, but if there is one.
Well, there's many. I don't want to presume what players will experience, because kind of in anticipation of our shared time together, I've prepared a lot of different conditions. And so, you know, if things can go kind of poorly, you know, depending on the kind of decisions that you make, and, you know, the things that are at risk for each of these characters, you know, their relationships and their living conditions, you know, their kind of health, you know, the amount of money they have, whatever, how they spend their time. It's all up to the players, you know. And so things can go poorly, things can go well. It's hard to have this attitude where I don't want to presume anything, but I have to kind of anticipate different styles of play and different ways, different paths through the game. So kind of, you know, it's up to you. At least hopefully it's up to you.
So tell me about sort of the art style, as well as the way that the music plays into, you know, going into different areas.
Yeah, well, I mean, it's kind of a game about games themselves and what they are generally kind of uninterested in doing, but they don't need to be. This kind of game can be made well. You know, maybe somebody else would be better at it, but I wanted to make the point. And so there's a lot of kind of video game-ness declarations about games. You're kind of reminded often that it's a video game, and the bleeps and bloops, blinking lights, pixels and chiptune music, you know. And so while I was working on the game, I wrote a whole soundtrack to it. I'm kind of a crappy amateur musician, and made a whole soundtrack for the game. But I hated listening to it during development. And so I was listening to these kind of luminary chiptune artists, really talented, classically minded guys, incredibly talented. And it's, not only is it great music to work to, it's a good work soundtrack because it keeps you busy and it's motivating. It's beautiful, complex, and harmonious. But also, they seem to kind of be doing the same thing I am, which is that, you know, they're making music that's profound. It's beautiful, it's complex, it's classically minded. It's great in all the ways that, you know, classical instrumentals might be, or, you know, choral music, you know, kind of technically. You know what I'm getting at, and so, but they're doing it using these toys, and they're tearing them apart, and saying that they can be good, and they can be disciplined and worthwhile. And so I just asked them, I think we're trying to do the same thing here. Can I use your music in a game? And they said yes. I couldn't believe it. And so got some great chiptune music. I mean, I'm incredibly lucky to have these guys, kind of really notable stuff, and it really helps kind of remind the players both of the kind of rhythm of these characters' lives, but also that they're playing a game at the same time.
So, you know, you go to these areas and you have discussions with people who feel like real people, and it feels like real discussions because of how deep they can sort of go, you know? Can you sort of tell me about, like, coming up with all this stuff and sort of the decision to, you know, have, like, small talk and, you know, all these different aspects?
Well, it's tricky. I mean, I don't know. I think we all kind of have this authenticity concern in our interactions. Like right now, like this interview, for example, is a little bit weird because I don't know that much about you. I'm talking about something that's like really important to me, but I'm kind of like surprised that I'm here. Like I'm surprised that somebody would want to talk about this game, you know? I am. I can't help it. Like I'm surprised that people enjoy it or that, you know.
I have a bunch of ulterior motives. Sorry. I mean, you know, just putting it out on the table.
I'm baffled by this stuff, you know, because you know, like, we're all in this together, you know. So these interactions, you know, like when you speak to a cashier, sometimes it's a little bit weird, but you maybe can have a meaningful interaction. You say something that unites us, you know. I've been a cashier many times, and you know, sometimes, occasionally, you can pierce that threshold and actually actually see somebody, you know, look somebody in the eyes and say something truthful. And, you know, occasionally that'll happen. But for the most part, it's boilerplate interactions and please and thank you. So, sometimes if you're lucky, and then most of the time folks are busy. Here's your change. Don't forget your napkin, that kind of stuff, you know. And so it's hopefully the, you know, like kind of like orienting it based on this kind of customer interaction premise, and then occasionally navigating the threshold of this stuff. That's kind of what I was interested in, because that's it's the same thing with games. Those kind of you know, the tropes and signifiers of game conversations and semiotics are like, you know, lives, failure, death, you know, rescuing the princess, boilerplate stuff. This game adopts those in kind of its own way, but simultaneously, sometimes, rarely, it'll try to pierce the veil a little bit, or try to breach the threshold and try to stick my tongue into your brain a little bit, you know, try to have a meaningful relationship.
It's really vivid imagery, by the way. Thank you for that.
Sorry.
You talked about what I found, you know, a point that I want to discuss is you talked about talking to a cashier, and then they say, you know, here's your change or whatever. Like, a lot of times, because the game is in real time, like, it's moving all the time, the clock is ticking, literally, you sort of have to weigh the importance of, like, judging somebody. You know, if you, for example, you go to the county clerk office, I believe, as a female protagonist, and you can talk to the janitor, who actually has some really interesting things to say, but why would you talk to the janitor? You know what I mean? Like, it's not really the kind of person you would expect to want to talk to. So, like, you have to, you know, really judge what, you know, a person, a book by its cover, I guess,
right,
basically.
Right.
Well, yeah, I mean, I'm kind of guilty of this. My friends and, you know, my family have always kind of given me a hard time, my teachers and stuff, because I like to kind of small talk and maybe get to know people, but and it's awkward sometimes, you know. I'm the kind of guy who would talk to a janitor in a courthouse. I do, you know, that's just who I am, you know. Maybe we can, you know, find out something. He can tell me something I would have known otherwise. Maybe we'll be friends. Who knows, you know? And, you know, it often, you know, I get my heart broke a lot in situations like that. Some people just find it awkward, and that's accommodated in the game to some degree, but I guess that's kind of my argument. I think it's worthwhile. You know, I think you should talk to your coroner. You know, you should meet your butcher, you know? You know, hang out and talk to the cashiers while they're closing up shop, or maybe if you're a cashier, maybe, I don't know. You know, and it competes with business. That's the point, is that you know, it's trespasses on our social protocols to try to get to know people. Yeah.
There's an aspect of this game, and they talked about it in the panel that we were at earlier about your game. Basically, a lot of the game is trying to emulate the boringness, I guess, of doing these jobs or of doing certain tasks, even like brushing your teeth. You have to actually, you know, press left, right to brush your teeth. Tell me about sort of your goal in doing this.
Well, it was kind of specific. I kind of have this weird thing, as I think we all do to some degree, where if you do this kind of like precise small task that's kind of boring at first, or tedious, frustrating, or delicate, like when Melanie, for example, like when you're the barista and you're selling coffee, you have to grind the beans, you have to shake, you know, fill the portafilter and shake off the excess grounds, kind of sweep the top to get a smooth top to the portafilter. You have to push down with 40 pounds of pressure to get a good top to the puck of coffee grounds, stick it into the machine and kind of lock it into place. And then once you've completed all these things, you have to remember what the customer ordered and then prepare the drink by adding, you know, cream and, you know, milk or chocolate or whatever they ordered, put the lid on it, hand it over to them, and then make correct change. And you have to do this for every cup of espresso that you sell in the game. Every single one. A lot of people find this kind of tedious and boring at first. A lot of players kind of bail in the first half of the game because they think I'm trying to bore them. That's not really it. It's only the first half. What happens is through repetition, you actually get really good at this if you're careful about it. You know, and you can fuck up a lot of them and start over, do it again. A lot of failure, and eventually you become really good at it. And then by the time, you know, the end of the week comes, if you've worked a lot and you've done this enough, it's just it's satisfying to be good at something, no matter what it is, even if it's seemingly mundane or trivial. If you're really good at giving people change or calculating correct change in your head, without the aid of a cash register, if you're a faster typer, or if you know the vocabulary and the essential moves of pulling a shot of espresso, or if you've memorized the essential fundamentals of making bagels, for example. Like, you can take these things into your own life, and they'll help you out, I think, in some way. They've helped me out, you know. My life's better for knowing how to make bagels because of this game. So, you know, hopefully that's what players will end up with. It's boring at first, but it's fulfilling. That's the intention. It doesn't work for everybody. Matter of taste, you know.
So before we wrap this up, there's, you know, obviously you're saying a lot about everything, really, about games. And so I would like for you to cite a couple of games that you feel either get it right or get it wrong, preferably both, actually, in the industry.
Oh boy. Well, I mean, I got to be honest, like, in this situation right now, we're standing in this gorgeous museum and we're surrounded by some really beautiful, strange, personal, artistic games that are so well accomplished. They're graceful and they have awesome finesse, and the people who make them are beautiful and funny. And so I'm just thinking about these games. I'm thinking about the Stanley Parable. I'm thinking about how fucking amazing 30 Flights of Loving is. Sorry, that's coming from Stanley. As I praise him, he punishes me. That's how he does it, you know? That's how Davey will do you. You give him a compliment, I'll hit you in the face. But 30 Flights is fantastic, and it's really sticking with me. I played it a long time ago, and it blew me away. I played it again, and again, and again, and again. And then as it kind of sloped off a little bit, just in the negative space, it's inviting itself back into my life somehow. And it's just completely captivating. It's obsessed with 30 Flights of Loving, and it does none of the things that Cart Life does, and it's somehow still among my very favorite things in the whole world. I'm stealing everything from that game. I was talking with some of the other developers here, and we're saying 2013 is going to be a good year for jump cuts in video games because everyone's going to steal from 30 Flights. It's just as simple as that.
Finally. Yeah. I'm a video editor, so I really appreciate that stuff.
It's funny, maybe you heard in the Well Played discussion yesterday, we're using the term smash cuts, which is new to me. I know match cuts, and I know jump cuts. I don't have a film background, but I know those. But I don't know smash cuts, and if that's what a smash cut is, smash me to death. Hit me hard. I love it.
Well put, sir.
I'm trying to think of a game that kind of did me wrong, but I'm just in a good mood. I don't want to talk shit about anybody. Maybe the AAA stuff just doesn't kind of do it for me, even though I end up playing them and just I'm captivated by how well crafted they are. The systems of beauty, how deliberate everything is, and yet how natural it ends up being somehow anyway. These are fantasies. They're mutually agreed upon, and it's kind of guilty because we're fantasizing together, and we're kind of, I mean, it's a lie. It's made up, you know, it's harmful. It's a departure. So I guess, yeah, you know, it's, I want games to have a closer proximity to the kind of lives that you and I live, rather than us both agreeing that this isn't good enough and we want to make something up that's better.
So let's wrap this up by tell people where they can get Cart Life and what kinds of transactions they can make in it.
Sure. Well, I mean, you can get Cart Life online. I tell you to go to my website, which is richardhofmeier.com, but I mean, that's asking a lot, so you should just Google Cart Life, because it, you know, I even mistype my own name all the time. It's a lot. It's a long URL. But it's free, and it's out now, and it's for Windows. I've heard mixed reports of it working on Mac through like Wine or Wineskin. Mixed results. So I wouldn't recommend it. I'm working on a port, but we'll see. Anyways, it's free. If you want, you can pay me $5, and you can get the bagel guy, Vinny, and along with the other two characters, the soundtrack, and, you know, there's another game that comes along with it, a little throwaway thing, and, you know, some little feelies and stuff. For the especially brave, there's a mysterious paint can with strange enchanted contents, like books and silk and cartoons and things. And I'll ship it to your house.
Awesome. And it's just going to have a bunch of copies of Farmville in there, right?
I won't say what's in there, but wear gloves when you open it.
All right. Well, you guys can pick up Cart Life, or I guess digitally pick up Cart Life, the basically a Farmville clone, online right now. No, definitely play this game. It's so different. It's one of those games that you really need to play. So thank you so much for talking about the game.
Oh, thanks. It's really been my pleasure. Thanks a lot.
So we signed off for a second there, but we're actually going to come right back up And I, you know, we got to talking after the interview about your next project. So can you just sort of tell the people at home what you're thinking?
Well, I want to be absolutely clear that starting the tape recorder was your idea. It's not, dear reader, that I was so urgent about telling you. It's that your correspondent here was curious about what I'm working on next. And I wasn't sure if I'd continue to make games at all because I had no idea that it would have resulted in an interview or anything even close to this circumstance. So I thought I would just move on to something else. But if people are willing to put up with cart life, it seems almost necessary to kind of maybe try their patience a little further. So the next one's kind of a locked room Agatha Christie mystery, in the way that cart life's a retail sim. There's some weird food and it's kind of fancy pants, kind of cartoon comic book style thing. And then after that, I'm almost hesitant to say because I don't want to like compromise the reward of working on it by telling you about it too soon, but it's about typewriters. Completely obsessed with typewriters right now. I can't help it. I'm possessed.
Now, what about typewriters do you like so much? Do you like the tactile feel or the clicks?
I'll tell you this.
Oh, okay.
Here's kind of a rant, but I'll try to go through it fast. So Remington Arms Company, based here in New York City, by the way, made the kind of flintlock buffalo rifles that conquered the frontier, as it were. And they made a kind of this action army pistol that the Union used during the Civil War, arguably a major factor, depending on which gun enthusiasts, anthropological gun enthusiasts you're willing to speak with. The final shot of the Civil War was fired from a Remington, right? But at the end of the Civil War, as you might guess, the demand for weaponry diminished really fast, and it was no longer profitable to use their resources in this way. And it was right around the time of the prototype typewriting machine, which these people knew was going to be amazing and change the world, but they couldn't get customers interested in the product because they didn't understand it. It's totally new. It's bizarre. They didn't understand what it did. And so they marketed the typewriter in the same way they marketed their quick drop pistols. They had contests of speed. So the fastest hands in the world came to the Wild West, and they had type-offs, and the fastest hands left with the prize purse. Awesome stuff. This is all true. It's true. Oh, it's awesome. And so it's kind of about that. The world's fastest living typist, by the way. I don't want to speak too soon, but he's helping me out with the game, kind of giving me a few pointers.
Wow.
Yeah, so we're working on it. I want to make it online multiplayer. You know, I want it to be the place in which Olympian typists compete with each other, and I also would like it if typing would be an Olympic game. But the point is, this prototype typewriting machine that Remington was experimenting with had the QWERTY layout that we use today on our cell phones and on spaceships. We're still using it. So we can compete with these typists, and I know how fast they typed and how many mistakes they made per minute, etc. And so you can compete with them in the game at the exact same speed on the same device, as if they were alive today. So you can type against their fucking ghosts.
Wow.
It's awesome. I can't wait to finish this thing and share it with you guys. But it's going to take some work.
All right. Well, you heard it here. That's what you can expect in the future. So not sticking to the cart life stuff then?
Oh, no. Well, I mean, I'm kind of sick of it, frankly. I should fix the bugs. People like it much more than I thought they would. And so I'll clean up the bugs and, you know, there's some content additions in the next build of the game, but I think the next major update will be the last one, I think.
Well, thanks again for talking about your new stuff and just again for really taking the time. I appreciate it.
I am my own favorite subject after all. I can talk about me all day. Thanks, man.
Thank you for listening to these Indiecade East 2013 special features. If you like what you heard, make sure to check out the accompanying coverage over at pressplaytv.com. You can also subscribe to our podcast on iTunes if you want to hear all this stuff as it comes out. So you could find that on iTunes under the Press Play Podcast. Thanks for listening, guys.